freedom. Turn my darkness to light. You welcome me in with open arms into an empty cloud. Not ashamed of the gospel, Lord, your power, your love that saved my soul. I'm alive in you. I live in the risen sun. Not ashamed of the gospel, Lord, your power, your love that saved my soul. I'm alive in you. I live in the risen sun. Darkness to light. You welcome me in with open arms into unending love. Not ashamed of the gospel, Lord, your power, your love that saved my soul. Now I'm alive in you. I live in you welcome me in.
In the house of the Lord this morning. Is that the best that you can do? How many are happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Are you saying thank God you wanted to sit down or? Oh, okay. Man, I kind of was. Man, praise the Lord. Woo. Well, praise God. How many were here last night? Praise God. Wasn't that awesome? Wasn't that awesome? Amen, amen. You know, God is moving. God is doing things. God is saving. God is redeeming. God is restoring. He's bringing back those, you know what I mean? So God is doing things in the house of the Lord. If you're here this morning, you're in the right place this morning. And like Pastor says, if you're here, you can't be nowhere else. Amen. Praise God. The altar call last night was awesome. It was powerful. You know, I don't know how many people came up, but a lot of people came up to give their lives to the Lord. If any of you are here this morning that gave their life to the Lord, and not just last night, but next Saturday, we're going to have baptisms next Saturday night. Amen. If you want to be baptized, your next step, you know what I mean, just following the orders of the Lord. Be baptized in the name of the Lord. So next Saturday night, 7 o'clock, bring a change of clothes, be here. There'll be a pamphlet, a notebook, something you can put your name down, your number down, and next Saturday we'll have baptisms here, okay? So if you were here, if you were one of the ones that got saved last night, you know what, get plugged in. Get plugged in. Don't wait. You know what I mean? Don't wait for the next battle. Just continue filling up. Continue filling up. The next step. You know what I mean? Get baptized. So next Saturday night, and as the ushers get ready to pick up the offering, I just want to say, you know what? God is moving in this house. God is really doing things. You know what I mean? So invite someone. Bring someone with you. You know what I mean? And we need to go outside the four walls and just tell someone about the miracles that are taking place here at Fire and Water. Amen. as we get ready to pick up the offering, just be obedient to the voice of the Lord. You know what I mean? And as the Lord directs you, as the Lord leads you, you know, just obey the voice of God. Okay? Amen. We're going to pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We glorify you. We give you honor. We give you glory, Father. We pray for this offering, the tithes this morning. Father, I pray that lives will be touched. Lives will be saved. Father God, that miracles will take place, Father God, that through this offering, Lord, that it'll go out throughout the world, my Lord, not just here in the city of Phoenix, in the state of Arizona, but throughout the world. Those watching on TV, thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you so much. We praise you, Father. We give you the honor. We give you the glory. To you be all the praises. And in Jesus' name, everyone says,
amen.
Amen. As the ushers serve the people now.
Flashes of light.
Blind to see is moving here in front of me, moving here in front of me. The one who made the deaf to hear is silencing my every fear, silencing my every fear.
I believe.
the one who does impossible is reaching out to make me whole, reaching out to make me whole. The one who put death in its place, life is flowing through my veins. His life is flowing.
Come on. God who brings the dead to life. The power of as we continue singing this song, Tony, come up here. I want you to lead us in a prayer. I want you to stretch out your hands up here to the altar. We got all these packages, CDs, letters, close to 500 of them going to the prisons across America. There's many in this room right now and even watching, but many right now that are here today is a byproduct of this prison ministry. I said last night, some of the greatest preachers, teachers, voices to reach a world for His glory are in prison right now. Yeah, you didn't hear what I said. Amen. And God says, and we know that all things work together for the good for those who love God and are called according to His purpose. All things. Amen. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. When I'm looking up here on this platform, I'm seeing great preachers, pastors, evangelists, singers, teachers, voices. Businesses, books. You're not in this place. No. I need some agreement right now. Amen. Because the Bible says in Proverbs 18:21, death and life in the power of the tongue. So our words create our future. Our words can create, speak life into others also. You want a miracle in your life? Here's a way to get, because sometimes we come in and it's like, man, I need prayer. How about you pray for somebody else? Hey! Look at somebody and say, hey! Huh? Watch this. What you make happen for others, God will make happen for you. Look at someone and say, hey! So we're about to mail these out. If there's anybody, and even watching at home, if you know somebody, a friend, family, or anybody that's in prison that can benefit from CDs, messages, literature, we send these out for free. Now, this is made possible because we can all do something, amen, to help make a miracle for somebody else. So we don't charge, we don't sit here going, okay, we'll send it, but you need to send us this much money so we can send it to your son or your daughter or to your husband or to your wife or to, do you hear what I'm saying? Some people are not in that position. So we need to continue, because when we take these offerings, some people say, oh, here we go with the offering. No, that's a life that you're sowing into when that offering comes around. And somebody even watching at home can sow into somebody else's miracle that's in a prison right now. To keep this going, to reach more for the glory of God, it takes everyone working together. Amen. Let's pray as these go out for God's fire. If someone's struggling with something, God's breakthrough, turn around. And also, whoever, some of them are in cells with others or within that unit, within that yard, you know what I'm talking about. Just a little bit. So once they hear it, once they listen to it, they give it to somebody else. Now some are just being encouraged because they're saved. But as they get it, they'll give it to somebody maybe that's not saved. And that anointing and the word will set them free, touch them, and bring them to the cross into a relationship with Jesus. Can we believe for that? Amen. Come on.
Praise God. Come on now. Everybody lift up your hands. Lift up your hands. Hallelujah. You know, there's nothing like, as we sing this song, turn it into a prayer. We believe the God of miracles. And as we extend our hands, as we pray for these letters, this literature to go out, let the anointing of the Holy Spirit, whoever receives it, whoever reads it, whoever may pray at in that yard, in that cell, wherever they may be at, that lives will be set free. Even in the middle of an incarceration, even in the middle of a drug addiction, of something going on, that they may be set free. And it starts here right now. So pray for that letter to go out. Pray for that person. Everybody, Father God, in the name of Jesus, right now, my Father, Father, we pray, Lord, we pray for this literature, we pray for this material going out to the prisons, going out to those cells. Father, we pray for breakthrough, my Father God. We pray that the fire of the Holy Spirit will fall down. Whoever receives it right now, Father God, beforehand, we give you honor, we give you glory for the testimony, for the miracle that's taking place, Father. We're praying right now, Lord, that in that place, Father God, in that place where this letter may get to, my Lord, that there will start, Father, a revival in that situation, that breakthrough and freedom will come, Father God, by the power of the Holy Spirit. We apply the blood of Jesus upon these letters, that these men, these women will receive, Father, their freedom, their liberty, salvation, healing in the name of Jesus, Father. Father, we give you the honor. We give you glory, my Lord. Right now, Lord, we come in agreement. We come in agreement, my Lord, that the power of God will fall down, my Lord. That the power of God will fall, my Father. That the fire from heaven will fall, my Lord. Touch, Father. Father, there's testimonies here in this place right now, from these letters, from this literature. Father God, we see, Lord, your hand moving. We will continue to give you honor. We will continue to give you glory. In the name of Jesus, we believe. We believe and we pray to the God of miracles, to the God of all miracles. We give you honor. We give you glory. In the name of Jesus. And the people of God said, amen.
Every hand lifted up, come on. Yeah. Lord, we thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you for your presence in this place. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for this opportunity once again to gather together to lift up your glorious and awesome name. It's a privilege. It's an honor. Thank you for your amazing grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your faithfulness. When we were not faithful, you remained faithful. Thank you for the cross, Jesus. And precious Holy Spirit, we ask you to continue to have your way in this place. Your church, your people. Your church, your people. This is your church. This is your people. And we pray that your will be done, your name to be glorified. Your will to be done. That as the word goes forth, that you will confirm your word in this place here today with signs and wonders, that you will heal, that you will set free, that you will deliver, that you will restore, that you will bring people into relationship with you, touch hearts, strengthen, fill. Not one person to walk out the same way they came in. Your power, your fire to flow in this place. And everybody watching at home, for your glory in the name of Jesus. So we can go out and share that fire with others. And bring hope to the hopeless. To let everybody know that there is an answer. To let everybody know that there is hope. There's hope. There's an answer to our families. There's an answer for our children. There's an answer to that relationship. There's an answer to that addiction. There's an answer to this country. His name is Jesus. Lift up your hands, shout, yeah! Yeah! There's an answer, and his name is Jesus. And every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. We serve a resurrected King, a resurrected God that still heals, that still delivers. Lift up your hands. Just say this: Jesus, my heart is open to receive your word. I give you permission to mess me up. Mess me up real good so I can mess up others for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. If you have your Bibles, let's just get right down to it. And I shared the scripture. I've actually multiple times here the last couple weeks, and I just I want to break it down, because everyone's looking for answers. And we were watching ESPN with Sheila the other day, and they were, because of the things that are going on in our country today, and everyone's got an opinion, everyone's got their thoughts, and all that talking and all that discussion. Look at someone and say, what a waste of time. It's like, well, I just kind of have to disagree with you. And then the other person's like, well, and they're going back and forth. And I'm thinking, okay, I mean, everything that's happening, The solution is in the Word of God. The answer, the healing, the restoration, the turnaround for this country is in the Word of God. I said it's in the Word of God. And it's very clear, and I mean, in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, look at someone and say, he's going to break it down for us. Are you in? Do you want an answer? Do you want a solution? Do you want to see this nation restored and healed and come back one nation under God once again? Are you in? Are you sure? No, I don't believe you. No, you're not ready. You're not real. No, are you in? If my people who are called by my name, who's that? So why is it? Okay, watch this. Okay, if my people are called by my name, will humble themselves. That's one. Look at somebody. That's one. Pray. That's two. Look at somebody. That's two. And seek my face. Three. Look at somebody. Three. And turn from their wicked ways. Shout four. Then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins and will what? If we can just get that one, two, three, four. Kind of like in and out. No. One, two, three, four, healing of the land. One, two, three, four, healing of the land. One, two, three, four, healing of the land. One, two, three, four. There it is. If my people, that's us. So we're talking about everything else and why this and why that and what, and if it wasn't for that and our leaders and we have, everyone's got an opinion and everyone's got. And the Bible says, it doesn't say about criticize. God didn't ask to give our opinion. What he says is, my people will just, number one, humble themselves. In other words, number one, stop complaining and stop murmuring. Stop talking about the leaders and what they're doing and what they're not doing. Because God's, they're there now. So whoever you voted for, let me help us. Either way, I'm not saying that some of the decisions are, all I'm saying is the president is the president. So does God say to the church, I would like you to give your opinion and your thoughts about the president? He says, if my people will, number one, and then what? Seek my face, turn from their wicked ways. I will hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and what? What's going to bring healing of this land and unity is if God's church, God's people, by example, will lead by example and pray, intercede. You want to change the destiny of other people? And the direction of people that are going the wrong direction, pray. Look at somebody and say, pray. You know prayer works, right? Prayer. let me first of all say this. Number one, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, will humble themselves. And what I'm saying is, I'm not saying. Now, there's some people, because in the Bible, and I don't have time to break this down here today, as far as leadership and what God says about what we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to respond to the leaders that have been placed in the church, leaders in government, at work, how we're supposed to respond to them. Even when we're being wronged, God is very clear about how we're supposed to act and conduct ourselves. Because you do realize your example and how you conduct yourself, even at work. Let me just insert this right now to help somebody. Do you realize you prayed that God use me, and God says, I am using you. You prayed, God, use me to impact a life. Lord, I have a gift to evangelize. I have a gift to teach. Then God brings somebody right in front of you, and it's your supervisor. It's the boss that you want to blow up. You You want to, you know that supervisor you're talking about, and you go to work, and while you're working, you're letting everybody know how much you hate being there and how miserable it is and the working conditions, and they don't pay me enough and they don't appreciate me enough, and I got passed up over here, and they don't give me, and I ask you, what? But you were the one that prayed, God, use me. Well, do you know that boss that you're talking about, that place that you're working at that you're so miserable? Did you ever think that maybe that boss does not know Jesus and you're the only Jesus they're going to see? But what word gets back to them that you're the one that's always talking about them, even though they're the ones that are signing the checks? Oh, Jesus. Your actions, the way you speak, the way you work, the way you conduct yourself, even though you might be working for a company or even a boss that is really, they're doing you wrong. They can do better. They could treat you better. But you humble yourself and you work hard. You work harder than anybody else. You show up early to work. You're the last one to leave. You work unto the Lord. You're not doing it unto the boss. You're doing it unto the Lord. That's what the Bible says. Do you understand that your conduct and the way you work could be the difference maybe for that person to get saved or not saved? And let me say this. And did you ever think that's just a stepping stone maybe? I'm helping somebody that's at work right now that you just don't, you're thinking about it right now this morning, amen, when you got up. Oh, Monday's right around the corner. I'm about to wake up. I got a deal. I just want to knock them out. Did you ever think that maybe it's just a stepping stone to where God wants, this is not your final destination, but God's seen how you're handling this time and this season in your life where you're working at, your attitude, your speech. Are you on time? Are you late? Are you finishing strong? Are you praying for your boss? Are you praying for some of the people you work with? Because God's saying, I'm called you to this, but I can't. But until you graduate where you're at now. See, some of us, watch this, some of us, you keep on having to retake the test because you keep failing the grade. Are you all right? Because you're looking at me all of a sudden. This is like, it was like, man, I didn't come here for this morning. Amen. Man, we were like, that was awesome. We had the Octagon Fighters, all craziness here last night. Praise. How many were here last night? Amen. Wasn't that awesome? And to God be the glory. But there's multiple things that could be happening there. God might be trying to get you to a place. So there's maturity so you can handle the next, so you can graduate to that next level. So it's just, you're just passing through. So don't look at it. Look at it from God's point of view. And the biggest thing of all is maybe this person does not know the Lord. So yeah, you're being wronged, but isn't this the position, the church, shouldn't we be desiring to be in a position where people that are in front of us are treating us a certain way, that don't know the Lord, that don't have the love of God, but you have the opportunity to change their direction? This country right now, so what I'm trying to say, I'm trying to bring it home here, because let me say this also. Do you realize also that, you know what, and when we talk at our job, sometimes it's like, oh, you know, you talk, listen, you know, if you don't like it, okay, first, it's like we pray, okay, and like I said, maybe they just need you, but afterwards, if you're still got an issue or something, then no one's making you stay. So as a Christian, you're wrong, and I'm wrong if we're complaining, murmuring, not working, being late, and going through all the, and worst of all, as Christians, let me say this too, this is not where I was going. You start something, finish it. We're talking about in the church today, we want to do all this ministry, but we walk away and we don't even give a 2-week notice. and you leave that company or the place you worked, and you're thinking, well, you know what, they treated me a certain way, I don't, you know, whatever. But then don't come to church saying, well, you know what, I'm ready to do this, and I'm ready to do that, and I'm ready to read, and I'm ready for ministry, and I'm ready to teach, and I'm ready to pastor, and I'm ready to get behind the pulpit. You ain't ready for nothing. Look at somebody, you're not ready. The church is mishandling things worse than the world. The world handles things better. They start something, they finish something. They go to work, they move on to something else, they give a 2-week notice, I'm moving on, I'm going to be quitting a couple weeks. They give them an opportunity. That's how you finish something the right way. Oh, let me say something else. In the church also, you're ready, you're not ready. You're supposed to show up, man, a position in the church. We're trying to reach a world, we're trying to say, and we don't even get a phone call. And you're the same one that's bringing all that drama to the church? How you're wronged? How the church is not treating you right? Did you ever look in the mirror and look at yourself? You can't even pick up the phone and say, you know what? I'm not coming in to do that ministry that I signed up for. Oh, now you're, woo, look at somebody, woo. Can't even say, you know what? I'm going to move on, but I'm letting you know a couple weeks prior so you guys can prepare. But see, when you don't do that, you're not about kingdom, you're about yourself. If my people who are called by my name will what? What's the opposite of humbleness? We can't even get this thing started until we humble ourselves. I'm going to get back. Let me just insert this. I have personal opinions about certain things that are going on, leaders that are in positions, but God says, you know what, pray for them. Pray that, I pray like this, Lord, when the decisions are being made in this country, let the decisions that are being made, when the mouth opens up and a decision's made, it's coming straight from your throne room. What's not of you, Lord God, don't let it happen. Or convict if there's sin or if there's something going on that needs to be changed, Lord God. Lord, you know, what we can't do, you can do, Lord God. You can change hearts. You can change directions, amen? So, Lord, your will to be done for this country. Your will to be done. Your name to be glorified. Your way in this place, amen? Hallelujah. So get a hold of our leaders in government, in president, in Washington, in the state of Arizona, the governor here, and the mayor, and right down the list, Lord, that everything that's being done is led by your spirit. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, we've got an answer to what's happening out there. But why is it that so many people in this country that are going to church and saying I'm a Christian are the ones that have the loudest mouths and have opinions, and are murmuring, and really bringing the greatest division? I'm going to say it again. Why is it the ones that are carrying the Bible, and you know they're Christians, are the ones that are getting on Facebook, and usually the ones that are quoting all the scriptures, that think they've arrived, they know it all. Picking and choosing, but isn't it funny how if my people, that it's right there, 2 Chronicles 7:14. So I didn't know that we get to pick and choose our verses that we apply. I didn't know this was just pick and choose. We believe it or we don't. The whole thing, amen? Are we all right? Are we all right? So, by their fruits you shall know them. By their fruits you shall know them. By their fruits you shall know them. So we're saying certain things. We're carrying a Bible. We're singing the songs. But our actions are contradicting what we believe. Period. We want to change the direction of this country. God says, if my people, if my church will stop talking about the problem and start speaking the solution, maybe we wouldn't even be in the condition we're in right now if the church would have been doing what it should be doing. Are you all right? Do you want more? I'm speaking to myself. Amen. That's all right. This is for me. Amen. We have a tendency. I'll get to the 4 points here. Because the reality is, we're so good at pointing the finger and justifying why we do what we do, or we end up where we end up. I was saying this the other day. You know, there's a lot of things that have happened in my life. And there's some stuff, yeah, there. I can even say, I feel like I'm in the right in some areas. But the bottom line is, I still made the final decision. No one forced me. Well, I did this, but you understand, I did this, or I acted this way, or I responded this way, because, of course, I mean, look at what happened to me, and look at the situation, and because of the situation, I responded the way I did. So now we're justifying and excusing our sin. So I'm saying I sinned because, and by the way, we all have a story. And isn't it about time that we, and it is, and I get it in here, man. There's some of the things that people have been through, most people would not even be here. I've said it many times. They would have checked out a long time ago. That's for real. But somewhere along the line, we got to understand that we have an answer. His name is Jesus. We let go of the past and we move forward. Amen? Amen. Your past doesn't define your future. Amen? Did something? Yes. And it's, you know, it's unfortunate and it's not right. Some things that have happened, you know what? I mean, I can't even comprehend. But if we keep on looking back, we're going to miss our future. We got to move forward. And then we got to be responsible and for our actions also, for some of the things that we've done. I'm just saying, as a church and as a country, this is happening because of this and this and that. And we're talking the problem. And God's given us the solution. It's about time that the church rises up and starts speaking and doing the solution. But we can't even get to the solution, the healing of the land, until we humble ourselves. We can't even get this thing started. The opposite of humbleness is pride. One of the biggest enemies of healing of the land is the arrogance of people and the pride. Thinking they're all that. Look at someone, you're not all that. You're not. You thought you were, but then you realize, that's why many of you are in here, this place right now, amen? You thought you're all that, but you realize you're not. We're all that in a bag of chips with Jesus. So let me say this real quickly. So if my people will humble themselves, watch this, humble themselves. So the opposite of humbleness is what? Pride. Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 34, he mocks proud mockers but gives grace to the humble. James 4:4, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Proverbs 18:12, before his downfall, a man's heart is proud, but humility comes before honor. Proverbs 11:2, when pride comes, then comes disgrace, but with humility comes wisdom. You want some wisdom? Humble yourselves. And let me say this too about humbleness. It's not like, okay, Lord, I pray that you give me some humbleness. No, the Bible says humble thyself in the sight of the Lord. He'll lift you up. That's a choice you got to make every day. Crucify that flesh and realize without him you can do nothing, but with him you can do all things. That you got to do that daily and understand that God died for all of us and we all fall short of the glory of God. And then you're not better or greater than somebody else. That's another thing. What? Let me read you a couple. Pride stops us from fulfilling God's plan for our lives. Pride, you know what pride says? Pride says, not me, no way, I'm fine. Never is willing to receive. Thinks that you know it all. When someone's trying to say something or share something, oh, I already know that. Of course, especially if you've been in this for a while in the church. Because you don't want to humble yourself to somebody maybe that just started off. It's like, man, you know, you're going to come and tell me what? What are you going to tell me? You just started this thing. I've been in this thing for 5 years. Yeah, and look at you. You're still where you're at. The first day you came in with your arrogant self. Maybe if you just shut your mouth and listen, and that's why God gave us 2 ears, one mouth. And receive and listen, maybe you wouldn't continue to be where you're at, and it's 5 years later. Because God will use an 8-year-old to get you a word. God will bring in somebody that just got saved, delivered, first week into this thing, and have a word for you that can change everything in your life. Apart from him, we can do absolutely nothing. And let me say something else. How can we go to church and say we are Christians and look down on somebody else that Jesus died for? How? Watching it at home. How can we say we are Christians and we look down on somebody else because of their nationality, their background, their skin color? What? You're not saved. You need to get saved. Amen. Looking down on somebody else, saying, okay, well, praise God, you know what? And we look down on them because of what they've been through or what they've done. And I've said this many times. Well, you know, because I've never done that, and I've never done drugs, and it's like, you know what? And we look at the way they're dressed or the way what they've been through, and we feel like, okay, you know, we'll receive them, but here in the corner, and but you're not at the same level. What the is wrong with the church? What Bible are we reading from? How dare you say you believe in Christ and look down on another soul that Jesus died for? Thinking you're better than somebody? You're greater than somebody? man, you walk around with the Bible? But again, you understand that the devil walks around and knows what. And, you know, the devil comes into the church with a Bible too, right? Jesus died for every single person. We don't look down on anybody. We lift one another up. We pray for one another. And we're together in this thing. I said we're together in this. And that's what the enemy wants, to divide, to separate, to bring division. To bring division in this country. The greatest enemy is inside, outside these borders. The greatest enemy to this country is within the borders. The enemy's coming to bring division. Because a house divided can't stand. We need to come together. As believers, all backgrounds, all nationalities, together for the cause. And he came to find that which was lost. Together, we need one another. I need you. You need me. Trust me. No one can do this on their own. And with him, we can do all things. Shout yeah. Yeah. Things that are happening today in our society and in our country, I get it when it's in the world for people that don't know Jesus. But I got a problem with someone who knows the word and is operating with that kind of behavior with one another, looking down on another person that Jesus died for. By the grace of God, as long as I'm here, that doesn't happen in this place, ever. This is the way the church should look. Look around. I said look around. This is the way the church should be. Look around. I'm so sick and tired of people in church thinking they're better than somebody else. Oh, we're together. We love one another. But then you push them to the side and you look and Bible says, humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. There's healing in humility. There's wisdom in humility. There's honor in humility. There's power in humility. There's grace in humility. How many people need his grace? How many people need God's grace? Well, he says, he mocks proud mockers but gives grace to the humble. I need some grace. He says he opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Humility comes before honor. In other words, God will elevate you. Not man, God will elevate you when you're humble. We're all trying to be seen and heard. God says, humble yourself. Go low. I'll take you high. We're trying to be high. That's why we're low. Wisdom to make decisions daily. The Bible says, look, you want some wisdom? Wisdom for your home? wisdom for your marriage, wisdom for your children, wisdom for your future, wisdom for next week, wisdom for 6 months from now when you need to make a big decision. You want to get God's wisdom? Well, God says, when pride comes, then comes disgrace, but with humility comes wisdom. There it is. We think we're wise. We're walking around all wise. We think we know we got it all together, and we're a mess. And everybody around you knows it too. Someone's like, really? Yes. The kingdom of this world and the kingdom of God are diametrically opposed. You want to go up for in the kingdom of God, you need to go down. You want to live, you need to die. When are we going to come to a place and realize it's him, it's not you, it's not me? We need to get out of the way. The biggest hindrance, the biggest, I said it, within this country is the division that the enemy's trying to bring between the people of God, number one, in the church today. Because if the church can come together with one heart and one mind, my God, amen, humble themselves and understand, I need you, you need me, all hands on deck. Together we get this done. Together, everybody's got something to bring to the table. Together, if we come together for his cause, we can change the direction. We can change things in this city and in this state and in this country. Everybody's got something to bring to the table. And if we're available and we humble ourselves and are willing to get out of the way and lift up his name, watch what God will do. His power. The other problem with the church today, we want a move of God. We don't have the power of God in the churches today. There's a power outage. We're having church. We're singing songs. You're hearing all these sermons. Man, that was so eloquent. Keep your eloquence. I want change. I want healing. I want deliverance. I want restoration. I want, what's the point? Oh, that was great. We had church. No one was saved. No one was set free. No one was delivered. We didn't have church. People will walk out. And when they walk out, I don't need anybody to be talking about me or this church. I want them to be talking about me. I had an encounter with Jesus. We're trying to impress people in church to get the applause of people, the acknowledgement. Stop it! Stop it! You're in the wrong place. You're in the wrong business. Stop it! Come in here every day, every service. They're coming up to us. Friday night, I'm contemplating suicide. Every service, I'm dealing with people coming and telling me I'm ready to take my life. And we're worried about how we look, how we wake up. We're going to do this. We need a revelation of what. Don't forget where you were. And there's others that need Jesus. They don't need your talent. God gives us talent and giftings to help people come to the cross. He doesn't give us a talent and gifts so we can elevate our talent and our gift above the cross. Oh, Jesus. does not give us talent and a gift or gifts so our gifts and our talents will elevate us above the cross. It's been given to us to be vessels to bring people closer to Jesus. Not talking about us, but them to talk about Jesus, an encounter with a holy God, a merciful God. Greatest is a servant. A servant's not looking for, doesn't have pride. A servant doesn't worry about what people think of them. I'm not here for your acknowledgement. You're not the one that died for me. You're not the one that stayed with me when I was about to lose my mind. And you're not the one that protected me and kept me. Some of you meant well, but I know who my source is. And in the end, I'm going to give an account to him, not you. Shout yeah. Church needs to die, man. We need to die of ourselves, our agendas, our will, our way of thinking. And understand, it's not you and it's not me that's going to change a world. It's our availability and our humility and our surrender to a holy God that saved us and delivered us when we were on our way to hell. Now we're on our way to heaven. It's our surrender to a God that was faithful when we were not faithful. It's a surrender to a God that died for us and shed his blood and was merciful and faithful when we were not faithful and patient with us. And his power working through us. And when people look at us, they don't see us, they see him. And there's power that goes forth. And his name is glorified, and people's lives are changed. You know when you got a church that's alive? Well, that's a real live church. Just because it's people, who cares? I said this a long time ago. People call revival, you know, and they, well, what do you mean revival? Revival of what? Everybody's saved. Everyone's saved, and you're all praying for one another for the last 15 years. How long are you going to pray for one another? Keep that. That's not revival. A move of God is when God's setting people free. People are coming off the streets, the highways, the byways. People are coming out of prisons and preaching the gospel. Amen. People are being set free. Addictions are being broken. Addictions are being broken. Addictions are being broken. The captives are being set free. Souls are getting saved. People are coming into the kingdom of heaven. Bodies are being healed, delivered, and set free. That's a move of God. And they're coming up, and they're rising up on fire, and they're going out and reaching others. Amen. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
If my people humble themselves. Can't see the healing of the land until we humble ourselves first. Then we pray. We can't even pray. How can you come to the altar? How can we even come to the altar when we got pride? How can we have pride and come to the altar and effectively pray for the nation, our nation, or our brother or our sister when we have pride operating? We can't even, many of us don't even come to the altars because we don't want to see people see us Hey!
Oh, yeah, I'm coming. Oh, I'm coming right now.
Right into your living room. We have altar calls, but we don't show up at the altar because I'm like, well, what are people going to think? They might think I have something wrong with me. You do have something wrong. You need to get some hell out of you, amen? And the one that's thinking, like, I'm all right, and I don't know, what are they going to think? You're the one that needs to be the first one up here. So how can I effectively pray when I can't even be humble enough to recognize that I first of all need help? How can I effectively be, how can I, when I know that I can't even humble myself and come to a place to know, you know what, I can't even take another step without God. Lord, I know apart from you, I can do nothing. I fall short. I need your help. Lord, humility, to not worry about anything else around you or anybody, to know that you're a mess and you need a Savior, Jesus, and not care about what anybody thinks or says, because you're not going to give an answer to anybody when it's all said except him. To be free from what people think. Some of us need to be free from the crowd. What are they going to think? Who cares? Why don't you say these words? Pastor Gus, do you want to know what we think about you? I can care less. That's liberating. What I do care is what he thinks. I said, what I do care is what he thinks. Because there's a time coming that I'm going to give an account. But the good gospel news is, wherever you're at, there's time to get it right, no matter where we're at, when we have, because we have our moments in this marathon. But the good news is, today we've got time to get this thing right. So number one, if my people will humble themselves, we got to humble ourselves, recognize, man, we need God, and don't worry, and we need one another, and apart from we can't do nothing, but together we can do something great. And it's like, you know what, it's not about you, it's about a world that needs him, amen? And there's a nation that needs God back in America, and we are the answer, we are the solution through God, amen? What a privilege, what an honor that God's given you, that God's given me, that God's given us the opportunity to heal our land, the generation. Humble and pray. Prayer changes things. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man, he faileth much. Prayer changes people's destinies. Our families need our prayers, friends, the world, this nation, our enemies need our prayers. Let me say this. Prayer life is needed much more than buildings or organizations. Who cares about a building if the church isn't praying? Who cares? Let's do this. Let's do that. Great. Now we got a great big building. We got all these vehicles. All these nice chairs. Oh, we got a really nice first class children's ministry now. Yalta's like, amen. Praise God. So easy. She's like saying right now. She's like, easy on that one. Amen. Who cares, Yalta, if we're not praying? A building and people coming in and people going out and nobody's changed. Looks nice. Lots of space, lots of room. It's all first class. Great. But if the people of God aren't praying, there's no power. And if there's no power, there's no change. And if there's no change, then we're a clique and we're a club and we're playing church. Are you here? Yeah. Speaking to myself, if we're going to go the distance and we're going to change the direction of a people, we need to start getting on our knees. The world doesn't need theology. What the world needs is neology from the church. Souls are born into the kingdom of God, not through buildings. And trust me, I'm believing that sooner than later we're going to have a building, a gymnasium, children's ministry, all of it, sooner than later. But I'm going to say it again now. Souls are born into the kingdom, not because of buildings. Souls are born into the kingdom only through prayer. Amen. 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 Bible says, asking yourself, seek and you shall find. Knock and shall be opened. Draw nigh to me and I'll draw nigh to you. Humble prayer and then staying with it until something happens. Seeking him daily. Not letting go until we see change. And you understand, the more we seek him, the more we talk like him, the more we act like him, the more we walk like him. In turn, let me give you this. I wrote this, I like this scripture. Jeremiah 33:3, call to me and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. We don't, what's happening is the people of God are not calling upon his name and seeking him, and we're missing the second half. And God's saying, man, I got some great things for the church, but I need you to seek me. I need you to call upon my name and watch what I'll do and watch what I'll show you. And then if my people who call my name will humble themselves, we can't even get this thing started until we get out of the way. Pray. Humble, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways. And turn from our wicked ways. Repent, the Bible says, then, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that the time of refreshing may come from the Lord. This is from the Azusa Street Revival. This is a quote from the early 1900s. The depth of revival will be determined exactly by the depth of the spirit of repentance. Woo, Jesus! And this will obtain for all people at all times. The depth of revival will be determined exactly by the depth of the spirit of repentance. Amen. Move of God. Do you see what's happening? Oh, God. And I'm saying God could do, but you know that, you know, we talk about miracles. Talk about miracles. You hear stuff around the world that takes place sometimes. People come in, it's like, man, so-and-so's in town, and you got to hear what they have prophecies for everybody. How about we repent? How about here's a prophecy. We need to repent, starting with me. Thus saith the Lord, repent. Here's a word. You want a word? Repent. Amen. You want another word? Repent. You want a word from God? Repent. You want a word? Repent. Here, thus saith the Lord, repent, 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 and turn to God. Here, wait, wait. I know you want a word over there. Come on. You want a word? You want a word? Repent. You want a word? Repent. 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 Forgive one another. The good gospel news is this. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. And it's time to get it right. But we need to clean it up in the church. Because if we want to see the healing of the land, it starts with us first. We can't expect a revival and a move of God across this country until the church gets it together. And God's grace is here. And the good news tonight is, today is, that we're alive and we're breathing. It's time to get it right. But it's not okay to park there until Jesus comes back or we go meet the Lord. Then something's wrong. And then I have to question our salvation if you're okay with your sin and are not convicted of what you're doing and where you're at. Are you all right?
Hold on. If my people will call my name, will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked. Why does he say turn? If my people will turn from the wicked. Because he knows. He knows how the church is.
A house divided can't stand. The church really is actually in worse condition than the world. Now you are looking at me, and the truth be told, you know what I'm talking about, because when you leave this place, you know how what happens behind closed doors.
Can we just, is that all right?
If I was like, listen, if it wasn't for his grace, I wouldn't be back here behind this pulpit. But one thing, and I'm telling you, it's been a journey. But by the grace of God, I stand here today, and I've learned some things. But let me tell you something. It's not okay to say that's okay. To say God understands. God understands if you repent, he'll give you the strength to give you the power to overcome. Now, some of us go through some things longer than others, and sometimes it is a cycle. And I always say, get back up. So I'm saying, don't give up. But you can't just say, it's okay, though. It's not okay. Look at somebody. It's not okay. Because eventually the anointing will take away the sin, or the sin will take away the anointing. And I'm talking out of experience. You better listen to this preacher. I know what I'm talking about. And there's time to get some things in order. We want to see the healing of this land. It starts with the church. But how can we repent if we don't even are humble enough to recognize that we need help? When people in the church are saying, I'm fine. You're fine. How are you fine? Look at your life Monday through Friday. You're fine? And here's the next step. In the church today, well, I wouldn't be doing those things if the church would have been more, or if the pastor would have been, or if the church would have helped. When you go see Jesus, and you go, well, if Charlie would have answered the phone, I wouldn't have went and did what I did. No. God's going to say, I'm not talking to Charlie, I'm talking to you right now. I'm done, I'm finishing. Do you know right now if I got everybody's phones? I know the pastors don't do this, but it's all right. If I got your phones right now, or got a hold of your password and your computers, I'm going to say close to maybe 50% or maybe even over 50% in this crowd right now, has stuff that you say, you wouldn't even, you were like, no way.
I didn't say 30%. I said 50 and maybe more. Pastor, how can you say that? Oh, I know. When you've been through stuff, you know. And we know the flesh and the spirit and the battle every day. But it's not okay to stay there. I'm going to say, don't let the enemy beat you up. Get back up, though. I said, get back up. And don't let the enemy steal your future, your destiny, your voice. Because God is raising up an army, and it takes all of us to come together, and we can make a difference in this country. And God's given us a word and a promise. If my people who are called my name will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, turn from the wicked ways, I'll hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal their. But the church needs to get right so we can finish strong. It's not the way we start. It's the way we. So let me help some of you that are going to go home today. They usually, you're coming to church and you're trying, you know, but some of you have settled there. Some have, I'm saying, and watch it. Some of you have settled. And where you used to get convicted and you couldn't even sleep in the midnight hour because of what you looked at or what you did. And let me tell you something. You keep looking, you'll start doing. Some of you are in the looking stage. Some of you are already doing. And now what's happening little by little, you're okay with it. You're like thinking, okay, well, God knows. God understands. God, before, man, you couldn't even sleep at night because of the conviction. But the conviction isn't what it used to be. That's dangerous. Some of you need to go home today and get rid of your. Is this your phone? Is this running right now? See this. What do you call this? Yeah, but this phone has access to a lot of places. Are you serious about the things of God? Are you thankful for what God's done in your life? Yes or no? You turn on the news and you're like, man, you know, and we talk about the nation and all the things that are going on. Do you want to see change? Do you want to see God move? Do you want to see our families changed? Yes. Do you want to see the city changed? Yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, some of you need to get rid of your phones. Yeah. Because that is your stumbling block right now. Or get a phone or have some accountability that doesn't allow you to go places. Because some of you are going places with this. What? Are we all right? Oh, come on. Is that really happening in church? Yeah!
Can I get a witness?
You know, me and my wife, as we're going forward, you know, we have one phone. Come realize more and more, the higher you go and the more you're doing for the Lord, this ain't, we don't arrive and it's, everything's going to be okay. It just gets more and more. And we're trying to shut every single opportunity and door. And where she's come from and where I've come from and things we've been through, it's, listen, if you learn from it and grow from it, praise God, it's victory. So I'm not going to sit there and let the enemy mess. And just like we've talked about what things, some of the things we've been through, we're going to learn from it. And we're going to use it now. What used to be our liabilities are going to become great, or I shouldn't, are going, they already are great assets for God. Because the way we minister to people, identify with people, we get it. But then God gives us wisdom. So we have one phone. And she didn't have a phone for 2 years.
Yeah, so I didn't have a phone for 2 years because some of you know my story. When I came here, I kind of... I went through a lot, and so I did the drama, checkmate too, and I remember when I said, I was like, okay, God, if I'm going to do this drama, I'm going to need to not have a phone, because I'm not exaggerating when I would get like 5 numbers a day. Like, I would just meet people, you know, and be excited about God, and be like, oh, your hair, or Jesus, or you need to be, you know, detoxed or get in recovery. And so it just was, and so I just, it's so interesting because God obviously did it for a reason. I went one time, went 10 months without a phone, and then this time it was 2 years. And so I was like, okay, if I'm going to do this, I'm not going to do it, but God's going to do it through me, this play, I need to just go to work and just focus on these lines, you know, because it's like I never did a real live play before. It was like totally all God. So then we started spending time together. And so, you know, I didn't have a phone. I mean, people would have to email me. And so people would be like, email? Who emails? I'm not on social media. Like, you know what I mean? But God used that for me. I needed that because I love people. And I will drop my life for people to help them to get sober or do whatever. And I did that for years. So God used that, and through prayer and stuff, the Holy Spirit led me to not be on social media, only do email. And in that, I learned, like, the people that if they really wanted to contact me, they would email me, you know? And there is a few that still email me to this day. And it's so interesting because a lot of people be like, well, I don't email. Well, then we're not talking. I'll see you at church. Straight up. So when we met, it was, like, about the whole phone thing. And we planned a wedding. I planned a wedding without a phone. Like, sometimes I would be like, can I just borrow the phone for a little bit? You know, I mean, that's like a miracle. I remember being so uncomfortable. Actually, me and Corrine helped plan the wedding, and Corrine's over the youth ministry. And I said, Corrine, I said, that's it. I'm getting a phone. And so I'm taking her home one day. We go into Walmart, right? I'm like, I'm getting a phone, right? I don't care what God says. So, boom, we go in there. And all of a sudden, it's like, woo, woo, woo. This alarm went off. And they're like, everybody exit Walmart. And I'm like, are you kidding me? And she's like, and I didn't say anything. I was like, you've got to be kidding me, right? And I look, and she looks at me, she goes, I don't think God wants you to have a phone. And I'm like, yeah, I don't think so either. So 2 phones work for us. It holds us accountable. We know, I know who he texts, who I text, who we call. You know, when you go through a lot and you have trust issues and stuff, it's like it just works for us. And some people could look at it and say, that's crazy. Or some of it could look at it and say, I'm inspired. I want to do that. Are you willing to do that with me, right? Yeah. So.
Wow. Look at someone say, wow. Did you hear what she said? Watch it. Now, her situation was she gets going and she can go to 20 different places, like, meaning well. And then the whole day's gone and it's like here, there, and everywhere, burnt out. And then in the end, it's like, you know, when you try to do multiple things, you're not hitting the bullseye and you're running around and then you get burnt out. So that was one of the biggest reasons. Okay, no phone. Planned the whole wedding. When I was on the phone and my car, I totaled my car. Listen to what I'm saying. Listen to what I'm saying. This is real. This is what we need more in the church. Not this like all nice, okay, opening, closing, 20 steps. Here it is. This is what we deal with Monday through Friday. Come on. She even said we keep each other accountable. Well, wait a second. Pastor, what do you mean? You need accountability too? And what? She doesn't try. No one arrives. So we're doing what we need to do to keep doors closed because we know about our crazy selves and how quickly we can get crazy. Are we all right? That's why we got to crucify this flesh daily. I don't care how much scripture you know and how long you've been in the church. Step away from the Lord a little bit. Stop reading the Word of God. Start isolating yourself. Stop being accountable. Stop coming to church. Stop having somebody having that accountability. And come talk to me in about a month or two. And I promise you, you're not going to be where you used to be. Ask David in the Bible. Ask Peter in the Bible. Come on, amen. I was driving the car. And I went on the phone to talk, and I'm telling you, maybe someone needs to hear this as we finish. We're going off a little bit, but listen, this is important. And I looked down to hit the speaker. As I looked down quickly to hit the speaker, looked up, the next thing I know, my car flipped, and I totaled my car. Like 2 seconds. You know, back in the old days, we didn't have cell phones. Back in the old days, that wouldn't have happened. Back in the old days, I would have still had a car. God's grace. I shouldn't have. I walked away from that. Okay, but what do you? Yeah, but a phone. We're sitting there, man, and we are allowed. Our God has become Facebook. What everybody else is doing. while the world is going to hell. We get on the computer. We go places we shouldn't go. The enemy is stealing our destiny, our futures, destroying our families, our relationships. We got to become violent with our faith, with the wisdom that God gives us through our humility. God gives us wisdom. We recognize if we're going to go the distance, these are some things we need to do to help each other. And we're doing what we have to do through the wisdom. So God showed us, and this is what we're doing. And guess what? It works. We're walking around with 50,000 things, and how can we reach people, man? When we're like, let me help. Let's say, okay, we're done. We're sitting here. You go out to eat. Let's go out to lunch. For what? So I can look at you while you're on your phone the whole time? Go to lunch all by yourself. We sit and eat now. You know, we sit and eat, you know, and most of the time she'll say, let's turn off the TV. It's just, you know, we'll sit down. Nothing. No TVs, no nothing. Even if it's 10 minutes. To actually talk to one another. To talk to one another. What? Look at some say, what? We go to lunch, we go to dinner, and everyone's got their phones on the table. From now on, say, you know what? Praise God. Yeah, we'll go to lunch, but if we're going to lunch on the table we're going to sit at, no phones. And then I can see everybody going to the table, and it's like, well, I need to go to the restroom for a moment. I'll be right back. And then that person comes back, it's like, I got to go to the restroom real quick. I'll be right back. Some things, God, we humble ourselves, we pray, we turn from our wicked, and then God gives us wisdom to just cut them off, stop them, turn them off, get rid of them, get rid of the cable sometimes. Some of you just have a basic thing on the phone then, and just a phone, just the numbers and nothing else, no web access. What am I going to do? What did you do before that? What are you going to do? You're going to get closer to God. That's what you're going to do. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Lord, we thank you for today. Are you glad you came? Yeah. Praise the Lord. What a great weekend. To God be the glory. Hey, next week? It's next week, right? What's next week? Is it Labor Day weekend? Next weekend? No, next weekend is Saturday night baptism. Sign up. If you just recently got saved. What's that? Yeah. So Mark Martin from Florida, many of you know who it is going to be with us the following week. So Labor Day weekend, he comes in on Friday night. He's going to be with us through Labor Day weekend and all the week after that. We're going to have services every day. We're going to worship, praise. We're just going to let God be God. I mean, God's going to do some great things. He'll be with us Labor Day weekend. So we're going to be doing tag team ministry together. And that's going to be starting Labor Day weekend Saturday night on Labor Day. So just keep it in your mind. Amen. If you're in this place, I just want to close with prayer. Can you imagine? I'm just thinking right now, really, the amount of time we spend on the computer or on Facebook. Can you imagine if we spent that time in the Word of God and in prayer? I want you to think about that. If the church, all the time they spend, I'm speaking, I've been there, I get it. That's why I'm saying it. Hours. And most of the time we're going through and looking at what everybody else is doing and what everybody else is saying. Man, I'm just trying to get through the day. I can care less if you're at McDonald's eating a cheeseburger. Here I am. I'm at McDonald's. So what? You know what I'm saying? late at night, we're like, can't go to sleep. I'm up. know, you see something back in the day. So what? If the church gets it right, the nation will be right. I just want to pray, if someone's in here that's never given their hearts to Jesus, it all starts, your miracle starts with a relationship with Him. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. And God is not intimidated with your sins. And it's not too late because you're breathing your life. So I want to give you that opportunity. And after you pray this prayer, if that's you, we're going to have some people here with cards and some follow-up information. Make yourselves available to this altar afterwards. But I want to pray this prayer. Watch it at home. Your altar is right where you're at, and we're going to dismiss. Last night, I don't know how many people were at this altar. I know it was over 100 easily. He's saying a couple hundred, 150. That was awesome. It's what it's about. If that's you right now, I just want us all to pray this prayer. The Bible says, those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For God so loved the world that He gave His own begotten Son, and whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Your passport to heaven is only one way. His name is Jesus Christ. You don't have to walk out the same way you came in. Your miracle, your turnaround, starts with a relationship with Him. Are you ready to pray? Let's just lift up our hands all together. Let's pray this prayer together. Heavenly Father, I need You. I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. I believe You sent Your Son Jesus to this earth for me. Jesus, I ask You to come in my heart and be Lord and Savior of my life. From this day forth, I'm all Yours. Wash me with Your blood. Renew a right spirit within me. And use me to impact others. I believe today, because Your word says it, that settles it, because I believed it, that I am saved, on my way to heaven. My greatest days are ahead. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, praise the Lord. We'll see you next service. God bless you.